And welcome to the 15th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind those members using mobile devices to turn them to silent. This morning we have apologies from Karen Adam, and I welcome Emma Harper, who is attending in Karen's place. Our business today is consideration of the Tuberculosis Scotland Order 2023. Just to remind everybody, we weren't supposed to be meeting today, but we had some questions over this order last week, so we're fortunate to have Sheila and Louise with us today at short notice just to clarify some questions that arose when we briefly looked at this. So I do welcome Sheila Voss, the Chief Veterinary Officer from the Scottish Government, and Louise Cameron, who's the Policy Officer for Disease Control Branch of the Scottish Government. We've got a few questions we'd like to ask, but first of all, I'll just kick off, and if you could tell us what the current situation with TB is in Scotland.
Yep. We've recently completed the stats for last year, and the good news is that we will retain our officially TB-free status. There was a particularly nasty breakdown last year, in a herd that had sent animals to a number of other herds, which then tested positive. But we know where it came from, we have traced it, and fortunately the position is not as bad as we feared it might be. That doesn't mean we should be complacent, but we will retain our status for another year. Although we're officially TB-free, that doesn't mean we have no cases. It means that it's a low and stable incidence. So in a normal year, we have somewhere between 10 and 15 cases within herds. It doesn't matter how many animals in the herd are affected, it's the number of herds that counts.
And how often are herds in Scotland tested?
It varies. One of the benefits of being officially free is that we're able to exempt some herds from testing subject to a risk assessment. The standard is that years, which is the minimum level for countries affected with TB, but our free status means that a lot of herds in particularly remote and rural areas, islands, have been exempted because they don't buy in very much, they send a significant proportion to slaughter, and they're small, so the risk factors are small.
Can you give us an indication, you know, we're disease-free, how many other, is that the norm? If you look at Europe, how many countries, what's the sort of with TB and countries that are disease-free?
It's exceptional that we're disease-free. Within the UK, the other three constituent members are struggling with pretty serious bovine TB problems. And in fact, I heard yesterday that in Northern Ireland, the herd incidence has gone up to almost 11%, whereas we're talking about that number of herds in an average year. England have significant problems, concentrated in some areas, and Wales. The comment from their CVO yesterday was that their free areas are getting worse, but their affected areas are getting better. So it's a mixed picture. Across the rest of Europe, some countries have serious problems. France and Italy, for example, the Republic of Ireland, whereas there are others, particularly the Scandinavian countries, that have a small incidence.
Okay, so we should be proud of our TB-free status and look to protect it.
Yes.
Okay,
it's valuable for a variety of reasons, partly for reputation and trade purposes, but partly because not having to test every herd every 4 years saves farmers a heck of a lot of time and effort, as well as government.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if you could say a wee bit more, please, about the reasons for amending the regulations. So that process that you went through and the reaction of stakeholders as you went on your way in doing that.
Yep. The legislation had been amended a number of times since it was brought in. So we were advised that it should be consolidated to make it easier for people to read and to understand. But as we were going through that process, there were things that we had learned from our experiences over the last few years, but also changes that had been made in other parts of the UK that strengthened provisions. And it seemed anomalous that with so much more to lose, some of our provisions were less than in England or Wales particularly. So we had a full consultation. It was out for 12 weeks. We publicised it widely. We didn't get a vast number of responses. I think it was 19. Having said that, that was more than the previous one, and it did include responses from all the big organisations covering producers. So the National Farmers Union, which covers approximately 60% of cattle holdings, but probably nearer 90% of cattle in Scotland, because the big players are members. The Scottish Beef Association responded, the British Veterinary Association responded. So it's a small number, but it was actually quite a large number of member bodies, which we think is... It's comforting to get that. And by and large, they were supportive of what we're doing. There were a couple of areas that we consulted on that didn't get general approval, and we took them back out again in response to consultation responses. But people recognise the TB-free status as something that they want to keep. It's very important to them, and so they want to do what they can to maintain that.
And just finally, Convener, you mentioned there the situation in England. I wonder if you could just clarify in general terms which areas of England we're primarily talking about here.
It's particularly the southwest of England, the areas Gloucester, Devon, but also creeping up the Welsh Marches, and Cheshire is something of a hotspot now. There have been clusters in Cumbria previously. There are areas that are not badly affected around East Anglia, but to an extent that reflects lower cattle density there.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
This is just a wee supplementary. When you said that the Welsh CVO was saying that where there are good areas, they're getting worse, and their bad areas are getting better. Do they have movement restrictions between infected areas and uninfected areas?
Not to the same extent that we do.
So that would explain the spread?
In part, yes. It could also be outward creep from an infected premises. It's an infectious disease like so many others. The respiratory route is one way of spread. So cattle in the same airspace can spread the disease outward. They also have a problem with wildlife, and wildlife don't respect farm boundaries, so they do tend to move out and unfortunately will sometimes take disease with them.
Okay, thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Morning.
As a nurse, I'm always interested in infection control and prevention, and obviously COVID has been something that has been really able to educate people about how we transmit infection. I'm wondering about, you mentioned Cumbria and say the movement of cattle from one side of the border to the other, and there's a negative results or changes from the current 60 days to 30 days as far as movement. How do farmers in England know that we've changed processes in Scotland, and is that a concern that we have?
They already know that we're consulting on it and the legislation is likely to come in. We publicise it quite widely through industry bodies such as National Farmers Union, through vet practices. DEFRA make their farmers aware of it. And there is a catch-up so that if people do it wrongly, then our movement systems will flag that up and we can play catch-up when they get here and retest animals which are required to be in isolation. Mm-hmm. So it's not perfect. We need to get the word out. Appreciate anybody's help to do that. Mm-hmm. But we are working quite hard to make sure everybody knows, and specifically markets and places where animals are going through have been targeted for communication.
The, the two farmers that I spoke to were very well informed and quite welcoming of the changes in the consolidation of regulation, so they didn't seem concerned, so that's quite welcome.
Good, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Morning, Sheila. In response to reducing the compensation to 95%, down to 95%, there were mixed views in terms of the consultation responses. You've mentioned a number of the respondees, but a number of them said that it could be a blunt tool, they needed clearer guidance with regards to isolation. And I just wondered if you could reassure the farming sector of why you made this decision, because it was also noted that this measure could actually have an impact on small farms and crofters.
Absolutely. The first thing to say is it would affect a tiny number of people, and they have control themselves over isolation. What we found recently, one particular outbreak, was that the farmer wasn't isolating cattle, and we believe that that was leading to ongoing spread through the herd, because we needed to take out a significant number of animals to slaughter, but it takes a week or 10 days to organise that, and by not isolating, it took longer to clear the herd at the end. So that's the first point. The second is that it's not designed to be punitive. It's much more intended to focus minds and to remind people of the requirement. We've always had the provision that we could prosecute if people didn't properly isolate, but that was a very blunt tool and relied on data gathering and the court system and things, so it didn't work terribly well. Reducing compensation, to be honest, nobody would have their compensation reduced by 95%, because they would get either the compensation that we give them for the value of the animal or the salvage value of the animal, which is what the meat processors pay when it goes to slaughter.
Yeah.
Although it says 95%, the chances are nobody would end up there. And actually, of 11 outbreaks a year, probably we've seen one in the past 5 years who hasn't complied. So it is a tiny number that we're talking about. We would also make sure APHA colleagues who serve the restrictions and require isolation, that it's discussed at the time what appropriate isolation is. So there's no dubiety. It's not intended to get people. It's intended to encourage compliance.
Louise.
I think as well, something that we have done as part of these legislative changes is we've brought in a definition for isolation. And we did that alongside this policy. It was something that was unanimous in the consultation that had support, that farmers and other respondents to the consultation would like a definition of isolation. So that's something we have included in the legislation to make it very clear what the requirement is and what the expectation is of farmers. And like Sheila says, APHA will work closely alongside the farmers to help them fulfil those requirements.
Yeah, I mean, that's very helpful. I just want to press the piece on the isolation, because that's helpful that there is a definition, but how do you actually prove that a farmer has not isolated? And what if you say that, you know, in terms of the salvage value and the market value, that it won't be 95%? What if we do have a significant outbreak and farmers are in a position? What could happen to these regulations to ensure that, you know, farmers are actually supported rather than penalised for something that is beyond their control?
It shouldn't be beyond their control, because we're not asking farmers to isolate reactors from other reactors. We're asking them to isolate reactors, infected animals, from animals that have tested negative. So there are a variety of ways in which that can be done. It may be housing the group of reactors, or it may be separating out the clean cattle depending on the numbers affected. But it will be done in consultation with farmers. The reactors are detected by a vet on the farm reading the skin result, and they at that time will issue the notice requiring isolation, and will talk through and, if necessary, visit the different parts of the farm and agree how it can work best.
But how can it be proved that that individual didn't isolate?
With difficulty. They would need to be caught not isolating at a subsequent visit. However, people who've moved animals around know it's not simple just to go and grab a few and bring them in or put them out. So it's unlikely that people would hugely play the system to have them in with the others most of the time and then bring them back in for an inspection or because somebody was coming up the road. So no, it's not perfect, you're absolutely right, but it will err in favour of the farmer rather than in favour of government.
Yep. I just want to make another point, Convener, that when government consults, as you quite rightly said, there were not a huge number, but the number that did contribute to the consultation responses were significant in the industry. So there was not a conclusive support for this. There was 30%, 30%, 30%, but people didn't. So there was do support, don't support, and not responded. So I think from the government's point of view, this particular part of the order has not been conclusive, but it is basically a policy that you have decided.
It's a policy that we consulted on with a lot of others. The formal
where is that? Where are those responses? Because I have trailed and looked for those responses. I can't find any that were not in that consultation, and that was difficult enough to find.
The formal consultation is only one part of the process. There was a lot of work with farmers' unions, with Beef Association, with Scottish Dairy Cattle Association, in advance of putting the consultation together. So the consultation is a process, the final part of
it. But how can a committee like this understand why a government is doing something if we don't get full sight and understanding of those particular responses? Because all we're seeing is 19 responses where on this particular issue, half of the people disagreed. Or a third, but a third didn't respond.
Okay. It's impossible to provide written evidence of all the conversations and all the scoping work that took place in advance of writing the consultation. We are somewhat at the mercy of people who choose to respond to a consultation, but I would come back to the people who responded positively covered significantly over half the cattle population within Scotland. The NFU, for example, cover roughly 60% of cattle keepers, but that equates to approximately 90% of cattle. So the fact that they were positive actually goes a long way to suggest that the majority of people out there are positive. But no, we can't say absolutely for definite, because short of asking every individual cattle keeper, we're going to have to rely on organisations to have done the work with their members.
I appreciate that, and thank you, Convener, for taking the time. I still have concerns about small farms and crofters. I still have concerns about the potential that, you know, we won't always be in this fortunate position, and I understand the measures that you're taking, and I support the other measures. I just, as for the reasons that I've stated, feel uncomfortable about this particular issue.
Okay.
Sorry,
I was just going to say, we did consult also on the fact that if you didn't isolate a reactor, potentially the compensation should be reduced for anything that subsequently came down with disease. And that's one of the provisions that we dropped in response to what came back. So actually, what is going through or what is proposed is much less than it could have been in response to feedback. So it's not that we haven't listened.
Okay, I've got Rhoda Grant, then Christine Graham and Alistair Allan.
Just a short supplementary on that. Given that in Crofton counties, a lot of animals use the common grazing, so different crofters using the same area to graze their cattle. And I'm wondering, would this impact... So obviously someone goes out, gives advice to the crofter or farmer as to how to isolate. But if they hadn't, and then... I mean, unlikely that the neighbours wouldn't be aware that there was something happening, but in the strange occurrence that they might not, and their cattle are still moving about with the infected cattle, would they be badly penalised given that they hadn't done something wrong? They just didn't have that information and somebody else had put them at risk?
No, we would only be looking to take action on people who had physically been told to isolate and who then chose not to. I guess the other thing to say is in crofting communities, TB is exceptionally rare. Most of the outbreaks that we get are in the southwest of Scotland amongst dairy farmers. Not exclusively, but there a large percentage of them there are there. We also get a few in the northeast because of cattle density. And there's very good evidence to show that herd size is a significant risk factor. So people who keep less than, say, 25 cows have a very low risk of getting TB in the first place. It's a disease that spreads well in closed areas, close nose-to-nose contact, a bit like COVID, which has already been mentioned. It's airborne, so lots of animals in the same airspace are likely to spread it. Spreading it out at pasture is much less common, particularly with the low densities that we're talking about in the Crofton communities.
Okay, thank you.
Christine Graham.
Yeah, I just want to understand about compensation. How much money are we talking about? Is it on market value at the time? How does it work?
It's market value, but there is a cap to it.
Right,
We still use a system of valuers, so somebody from the local market will go out and value the cattle based on how they look, what their production records are, whether they've got a calf at foot, whether they're in calf,
okay,
what their breeding is. And that's the level of compensation that we normally use, up to a cap of 2,500.
I believe it's 5,000 for
bulls.
Non-pedigree and...
Right.
7,500 for
okay,
pedigree.
Okay, so it's gone up. So that's a significant amount of money. Over and above
that... That's 100% figure, is it?
Yes.
And so it's 50% if it's unclean. I'm trying to understand
yeah.
the money so, that goes in, that goes right. back to the farm. Because I'm trying to see, is compensation, as I understand it, not a fine?
No. Compensation...
Which is the 95% which has been dropped, so it was more like a fine. Am I right?
When we choose okay. to slaughter an animal, we pay compensation to the farmer for the value of that animal.
Yeah, right.
So if it's a £5,000 animal, he will get £5,000 for it, provided it's been isolated and it's clean when it goes to slaughter.
Right.
So he should not lose out on
right.
that. If that farmer has chosen not to follow the advice
right, I followed
and
you.
Has the animal out and about, what we're saying is they won't get the £5,000. They will get a small percentage of that, which realistically will be what the animal gets from slaughter, which is likely to be 1,500, 2,000.
So
in general terms.
What's this 50%? That's the 50% reduction.
So the 50%
right.
is if the farmer sends an unclean animal
to
slaughter. So legislation for food safety is that animals going to slaughter must be clean. They shouldn't be caked
yeah, I understand
in
that. Yeah.
shit, basically.
Yeah.
We already have the powers... or the Meat Hygiene Service already have the powers to discard unclean animals because
okay.
they're a food safety risk. what we're doing is sharing that risk with the farmers. So what we'd found was very, very occasionally farmers thought, oh, well, we'll get the compensation so we don't need to send them clean.
Okay.
This is an attempt to encourage people to do what they would be doing anyway, which is for human health, but also for animal welfare purposes. It's not something that we would intend to use regularly, and it is something that's done in the other UK administration.
Yeah, I saw that.
We were behind the curve with this.
Yeah, I'm just interested in the figures. I don't know how much money we're talking about. Thank you.
That, I'm glad you've clarified the clean arables, because my first reading was it was the TB wasn't necessarily the trigger for that, and it was a reduction anyway. And I couldn't quite understand why there was any compensation for animals that are sent to slaughter that are not clean.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. Alistair Allen.
Thank you. You've kind of touched on this already, but just really to clarify, you're essentially saying that the Scottish regulations are now going to be similar to those in England, or will catch up with those in England, and presumably be broadly similar to those in the EU as well, are they?
Yes. The changes that we're making bring us back into line with the EU and also with the WOA, which is the World Organisation for Animal Health Code. So for a number of years after we got our officially TB-free status, our controls were over and above. Over time, they've slipped behind, and so most of what we're doing is bringing ourselves back up to the same level as everybody else.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. I'm just kind of intrigued at some of the conversation that you were having there between yourself and Rachel Hamilton when you're talking about the potential for a farmer choosing not to isolate infected cattle. Now, as you know, my background is in livestock. I could never dream of allowing infected animals to go back into a herd or back into a flock. How many incidences of farmers not isolating what they know to be an infected animal would you ever get?
Probably two in the 12 years I've been doing this job. It's tiny.
Yeah.
It's a tool to encourage and to make sure that those who perhaps are not as assiduous as yourself
think
a bit more about it.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just, this is for the record, I just want to be clear on the whole process, and it might be helpful for anybody who's listening into this session. So if I was a dairy farmer in the south of Scotland, as I was, but I decided to buy some cattle from Devon, which is an area which is of high incidence of TB, what is the process that I would have to go through now, and what will the process be once this legislation comes into force?
The only change is that if you're buying animals from a high-risk area now, the last test will be valid for 60 days. So to buy an animal in the middle of May, it could effectively have been tested in the middle of March. What we're doing is reducing that period because, A, it's changed internationally, but B, the longer from the last test, the more chance there is that it's become infected since it was tested. So shortening the window means that there is less chance of bringing infected animals in.
Okay.
They will still have to be post-movement tested once they get to Scotland to try to make sure that anything that's been infected between the test and the move is caught before it spreads disease around Scotland.
Okay, and just on that, so, you know, Rachel Hamilton touched on the compensation, the levels of compensation and whatever, and also some of the responses. So we're not clear why people were for some of the proposals, some of the policies, and some were against. What's unclear to me is the ones that were against the current policy, did they want to go further? So should there be more emphasis put on individuals to try and avoid buying cattle from highly infected areas at all cost, so there is no compensation? So if I was good to go down to Devon, I would be aware that I was taking a risk. And if I were to bring back an animal, why should I get compensation when potentially I'm putting the whole health status of the Scottish herd at risk? Was there any consultees, responses that came back and suggested the Scottish Government should go further?
I'm not sure there were formal responses.
I think we often get feedback from some individuals and some organisations that we should go further, but we do need to take into consideration what's fair and what we're seeing in other countries do, and making sure that we're not taking things too far. As you can appreciate, you know, we're trying to make some changes to compensation today, and the kind of challenge we receive on the back of that, because, you know, it's quite emotive for a lot of people as well. So we do need to take into consideration, you know, how far is too far, and but you're absolutely right. If you're purchasing cattle from high risk areas, it does present a higher risk. And at the heart of all of these changes, we have our officially TB-free status. So when we've considered all of these policies, we're thinking about how can we protect that officially TB-free status and what is in the best interest of the farmers in the country, and to stop spreading any kind of disease coming in. So we take that very seriously.
Okay.
And we've made it as easy as we can for people to understand the status of cattle that they're buying, so they can go onto websites and check the status of a herd. Obviously, if the herd is under restriction, they can't buy the animals. But if it was released from restriction last week, they can find that out fairly straight in a fairly easy manner and decide for themselves if it's a risk that they want to take, recognising that it will have to have been tested, which may add to the cost, and when it gets to Scotland, it will have to be tested again at their expense.
Yeah. I suppose the nature of the secondary legislation is, if things were to ramp up in other nations, that you could come back with further restrictions or reductions in compensation or penalties if you thought that would help preserve our status.
Yeah, it's a fluid situation. Yeah. We don't want to be disproportionate in the action that we take, but equally we don't want to encourage people to do things that risk something that's very valuable.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Just to kind of go back to what Convener was saying earlier, that we should be proud in Scotland that we have a TB-free status. And when I'm thinking about biosecurity, it's about being aware of that, how diseases spread and what practical measures can be implemented to reduce spread. And I'm thinking about other bovine diseases like UNES, for instance, as well. So TB is not the only one. But my perception is that farmers are very aware of how diseases are transmitted, what they need to do to prevent it, and isolation is part of it. How do you perceive the attitudes of the farmers? Because I think they're doing a great job, and we should go back to that word and say we should be proud of our producers in Scotland. So how do you feel about that?
The vast majority are doing the right thing. There are a small number who don't take it seriously because either they don't have the information or because they've inherited a system from a father, a grandfather, and they've never felt the need to do it. But we're getting the information out that biosecurity isn't about single diseases. What they do to prevent TB will help against BVD. What they do about yonies will help for other diseases. What they do about control of parasites will have knock-on consequences. So we're generally promoting biosecurity, but not just for one disease.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. Sorry, I've got a frog in my throat now. You've touched on already the percentage reductions in compensation, explained quite well, I think. I just wonder if you could explain how the government decided on the actual levels of compensation.
The levels of reduction?
Yes.
The unclean cattle is similar to what's happening elsewhere. The 95% was a figure that came up in discussion with farmers' unions and others prior to consultation, because one of the things that we get regularly are calls from people to do more to protect the status. So it was not a random number, but it was a number that was drawn in consideration with them, recognising that it's unlikely that anybody would ever have that level of reduction because the salvage value will almost always be greater.
Okay, that's helpful. And then on the issue of animal cleanliness, the Scottish Beef Association and IAAS noted that they thought it should be animal cleanliness should be assessed on the farm, not the abattoir, because once animals are loaded, then the farmer or keeper loses control of the cleanliness. I wonder if you could give your response to that.
Yes, but the sort of problems that we're talking about are not some wet dung from a lorry. We're talking about animals that have clarts, is the word I would use, tags to their skin that have been there for months and months. So there is a small element, but generally animals that get dirty in transport stand in the lairage for 12 hours when they arrive and they're clean enough again by the time they go for slaughter. Animals that have been dirty on farm for weeks or months, they can't do anything to change.
It's a different thing.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you for that.
I think the official report will have to have an appendix with some of these
I'm sorry.
Rural terms. We're all smiling because I haven't heard that word for quite some time. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, it's nice to hear a Scots word coming in, Clart. Thanks for coming this morning, and it's great to hear that Scotland has this TB-free status, and clearly what you're working on is really about protecting cattle farmers with this SSI, and it was good to hear also this piece that you're focusing on the biosecurity aspect, that we're getting away from a single disease approach and actually the whole system. But I think one of the reasons that we asked to have this evidence session was around the engagement process, and you have touched upon that already in previous answers around the fact that NFUS was one of the respondents, and they represent 60% of the cattle keepers and 90% of the cattle in Scotland. So even though the numbers were low, there was actually, they represent a great deal of people who work with cattle. But I think we'd like to hear a little bit more maybe about the engagement process, and also I think ongoing afterwards, how do you kind of keep that relationship going?
So one of the things that I do is have quarterly, roughly, stakeholder meetings. So that's where officials from my team and myself get together with representatives of the various different bodies that we work with. So that's NFUS, it's Scottish SPCA, it's the Institute of Auctioneers, it's Meat Wholesalers, Scottish Beef Association. There's usually about 30 different groups represented there. It includes the vets. And we use that as a policy development forum so that we talk to them well in advance of coming forward with proposals about what they would like, what would help them, and we sound ideas off them so that we can have that blue sky idea. What if we reduce compensation for dirty cattle or whatever it is? And there's that discussion in that forum to gather the feeling of the industry across the piece before we ever put pen to paper about it. And that will continue. The standard is quarterly. During COVID, we were meeting weekly. In avian flu, it's been up, it's been down. But quarterly is an absolute minimum. And the intention is that we are as open as we can be to talk about what's coming up, what's on the radar, and to get feedback about what's concerning the industry as well.
That's very helpful to hear that they're actually really involved in almost co-designing policy that's coming forward.
Yes.
Does the quarterly meeting group have a name, just so that we can understand?
It's the Animal Health and Welfare Stakeholder Group.
Great, okay. That's great.
And you're very welcome to come along anytime you want.
Thank you very much.
Anybody.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Christine Graham.
No questions might have been asked already about guidance. I think you've answered a question about guidance on what isolation means, I think. Rachel, you touched on that, unless you have anything further to say.
I don't think so.
I have nothing to ask.
No. Jim Fairley.
One final question from me is, going back to the point that Rachel raised earlier on about what if we get a flare-up of infection, how is that going to affect in terms of compensation, etc. But given the rigorous scrutiny that there is and the diligence of the farmer community, how likely is a flare-up of TB to happen in Scotland?
Oh, my crystal ball's a bit cloudy. It depends a lot. It is clarity. It's one of these interesting ones. It depends to an extent on farmer behaviour. I would much rather people weren't buying animals in from areas with TB, but I recognise why some people do. Mm-hmm. It depends on our surveillance systems to pick it up quickly, and it depends on when it is picked up, the appropriate control measures being put in place, such as isolating animals. Hand on heart, I think it's unlikely that we would get an acute flare-up, but it only takes one farm, as we saw last year, one farm with disease that had probably been there for a year or 18 months undetected, had seeded disease to another, I think it was 18 farms we traced, of which 7 or 8 were positive. So it's not impossible. What matters is that when we find it, we deal with it robustly and quickly. And so part of what we do is tracing backwards and forwards. You get an animal that's infected, we immediately go back to find out where it's been, what it's been in contact with, to try to determine where it may have come from, which involves testing a range of herds. And we also look at anything that's left that farm and test them and the herds that they're in. So it's not impossible, but it's unlikely, I think, is probably as much as I can say.
OK, thank you, Kim.
Rachel Hamilton.
Scattergun questions for you. First of all, just going back to the current measures that are in place, I presume that anyone breaking TB rules would have their farm payment reconsidered. Secondly, they could potentially be subject to a fine. Why aren't those measures that are currently there sufficient?
Yes, it can be taken into account for cross-compliance. It's not often done because it rarely happens that people don't follow the measures. It is exceptional. And by the time we get there, the farm, one of the farms that didn't comply, actually lost about 90% of his stock in the end. So he didn't have a lot left to lose by that point. That was the first point. I'm sorry, I've forgotten what the second point was.
A fine up to £5,000.
Yep. The fine we can use, but that relies on a court case and taking up time, getting it through the procurator, deciding whether it's in the public interest or not. And what we found recently is that procurators, like everybody else, are very busy people. And sometimes it seems quite small change in comparison to rapes, murders, and the other things that they're dealing with. So it's not that we haven't tried to use it, but it sometimes proves difficult to take it through.
Okay, just on the point that the BCVA had said that they need more detail regarding the ability to resource and carry out this approach. I presume that you're aware of that. So
yes.
What would constitute a herd that wasn't subject to pre- or post-movement checks? And I don't mean that in a ridiculous way. I mean, why would somebody not have to go through that?
If they come from a low-incidence area. So we don't require...
So Scotland is a low-incidence area.
Scotland is a low-incidence area, so we don't require pre- and post-movement checks of cattle moving between farms in Scotland, or from the low-incidence area in England, where... the number of breakdowns is very low. So from East Anglia, from Northumberland, they don't have to have these tests. If the animal comes from a high incidence area where TB is endemic, they have to be tested before and after. And if they come from a high incidence area to a low incidence area in England, then they will still be post-movement tested unless they've been tested in the low-incidence area of England. It's quite complicated.
So if there are 10,000 cattle moving into Scotland every year, how many of those are coming from high-risk areas?
Oh, 2,000 maybe.
Right, so that's how many checks are being done currently. Okay, so
that's about right. I'd have to get back to you.
Yeah, just I'm very interested in the probability of risk here.
One of the things that we found since we became officially TB-free and required post-movement testing from high-risk areas is that farmer behaviour has changed and people are now looking to source animals. They're thinking more about it, and that's been a really positive benefit because people are thinking about risk for themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think, from a personal comment here, is that we need to make sure that we support farmers across the United Kingdom, because if a farm has a breakdown, it can be devastating, not only for the family's mental health, but for their, the financial impact as well. And farmers do not ask for bovine TB in their herd. This is something that can happen with unintended consequences of purchasing whatever it might be, or indeed something that hasn't been identified through testing. So I think it's very important that whilst we recognise that we are, it's great that we've got this status in Scotland, that this is happening across our United Kingdom, where the supply chain is integral to Scotland's success as well.
Yeah, absolutely. For all we don't have TB in Scotland, TB is still the biggest spend in my budget because of the testing that we do, the compensation that we pay, and so it's in my interests for England and Wales to solve their problems so that there isn't a risk coming into us with animals. Mm-hmm. So as CVOs, we work very closely together. We have monthly meetings, and every quarter we have TB liaison group meetings to understand what the different administrations are doing. But there's the occasional person who indulges in dodgy behaviour. Most people are unfortunate victims. We're lucky we don't have a wildlife problem here. That would be so much worse, and we need to keep it out of our wildlife.
Thank you.
Thank you. I tend to agree. Last night at the BVA dinner, the British Veterinary Association, there was certainly a fantastic discussion and recognition of the issues we have right across the UK with vets and representatives from every part of the country, so that was helpful. I've got one very short technical question. We touched on cross-compliance and potential cross-compliance penalties. Will there be need a requirement for animal health provision on the face of the Agricultural Bill regarding animal health and cross-compliance? Because we've started consideration or pre-ledge consideration of the Agri-Bill, but that will be before us after the summer.
Yes, the intention is that there will be animal health provisions within it. Most of the legislation that we currently have for animal health is predicated on the... my mind's gone blank. It's legislation from 1981, the Animal Health Act, that's it. But that in itself needs modernising in some places. So the intention is that there will be some provision within the Agriculture Bill, but we don't know exactly what yet. We're still in discussion with lawyers and others across the directorate.
Great. Thank you. That's really been hugely helpful, and we do appreciate you coming in at very little notice, but that's certainly been hugely useful, not just only for this piece of legislation, but for the committee to get a better idea of actually what tuberculosis looks like across Scotland. So thank you very much for taking the time today. That concludes our business for today, and I formally close this meeting. My apologies. The most important thing is that I ask members whether they have any comments on the instrument. We have no further comments. Thank you very much. That concludes the business for today.